Hello, everyone. This is John Blackstone. Again, you know, I got to tell you, I've been making a lot of interesting videos lately, and I know that a lot of you got turned onto my channel through my videos about Star Wars and Jaws, but I got to tell you, I am just on a roll right now with Elton John. It started with the video that Jeff and I made, and then I've been looking back on a video I made in the past. Go and check out a couple of videos I made. One is called Dee Murray, Nigel, Olsson, Elton John Stories. And then another one is a video of the recording session when Nigel Olsson came in and played on my album. You might want to watch those because I give quite a bit of background about myself and my involvement in music. I've been in music for many, many years. I worked in the industry in Nashville, in Seattle. I'm a producer. I'm a singer, songwriter, recording artist, guitar player, bass player, sort of drummer. So I just want you to know as you watch this video, which I'm about to present, I want you to understand that I'm coming from that perspective. I'm a real music fanatic, a music freak, if you will. Elton John was kind of my first love. I discovered Elton John when I was young. First single I bought was Crocodile Rock, and shortly after I played Crocodile Rock over and over again, I started playing the B-side, which was Elderberry Wine, and I just got hooked on that song, and that launched me into just wanting to hear all of Elton John's music, and which is what I did. But in this video, what I'm going to talk about is the Elton John Band.
We'd like to introduce, before we go any further, everybody on the stage. Seeing as it's called the Elton John Band now, not just Elton John. First of all, on the far right-hand side of the stage, one of the original members of the band, on the bass guitar, Dee Murray on the bass. Thank you. And standing next to him, the blonde whiz kid from Edinburgh, Mr. Davey Johnstone on guitar. On the drums, another original member of the band, Mr. Nigel Olsson on drums. The haute couture of pop music, Mr. Ray Cooper on percussion.
And Elton John, of course, on piano and vocals. There's such a story to this band. When Elton was first starting out, the first band that he put together as he went out and started, you know, demonstrating his songs and playing live around London, he put this band together, which was Dee and Nigel. They went as a three-piece to the United States, and his career exploded overnight. And they were this incredible unit, a musical unit, the three of those guys. They had played together so much, and they had basically formed such a synchronicity, and by the time that they added Davey Johnstone to the lineup of the Elton John Band, and later Ray Cooper, the three of them, Elton, Dee, and Nigel, were so impeccably and incredibly tight, which is demonstrated on the album 11-17-70. I'm going to play some music, live music. I'm going to play parts of some of Elton John's classic tracks. And I'm just going to point out to you, from my perspective, with my musical background, all of these moments, not all of them, there's no way I could cover all of them, but I'm going to cover many moments that I believe demonstrate that the Elton John Band was the best band, both as a recording unit in the recording studio and as a live band in the 1970s. So I'm basically gonna sell you on that, or attempt to sell you on it. I'm gonna play not only just tracks that you know, but I've dug really deep and pulled out some instrumental things that I've collected through the years, some bootleg live recordings I've collected through the years, all kinds of really interesting stuff. So this is not a surface dive, this is a deep dive. And this is hopefully the video that will prove to many people that they really were the best band of the 1970s. To start off, I'm going to play just a little bit of Dee, Nigel, and Elton as they were performing in New York City during a radio studio program that they did that was later released as 11-17-70. This gives you kind of an early glimpse of how hot they were and how tight and on fire they were as a band. This is Take Me to the Pilot.
If y'all feel that it's real,
you, I'm on trial, and I'm hanging in your prison like a coin in your man. I am dented and I'm spent with my treason.
Here come Dee and Nigel.
Through a glass eye zone is the one danger zone. Take me to the pilot for control. Take me to the pilot of your show. Take me to the pilot, lead me to the table. Take me to the pilot, I'm a danger. Take me to the pilot, lead me to the table. Take me to the pilot, I'm a danger.
If you've never heard this album, you absolutely have to hear it. It is stunningly incredible, the three of them playing together, easily amongst the greatest three-piece bands of all time, which is such a shame because they never get mentioned in these lists, you know, these lists you see in Rolling Stone and all these magazines. To me, all those lists are a joke. They're basically popularity contests, much like the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame has become, and the Grammys for that matter. If you're really serious about music, you learned a long time ago that those lists are a bunch of, you know what. Okay, this is another track from 11-17-70.
She's a honky-tonk woman. Give me the honky-tonk blues. She's a honky-tonk woman. Give me the honky-tonk blues.
Smoking hot.
To try to take upstairs for a ride. She tried to hear me right across her shoulder. And I just can't seem to think her off my mind. She's a honky-tonk woman.
You can just hear those guys, man, they are so on fire. And this is obviously an incredibly exciting time in all of their career. But Elton is just like riding this wave that started when he played the troubadour. And man, you can hear the audience. They're just in the palm of their hand. That's a really incredible little taste. That's in 1970. Okay, I'm going to play a little bit of one of my bootlegs. This is them in 1972. This is the first tour that Davey had played with them, introducing songs from the Honky Chateau album. Check out this version of Susie.
1, 2, 1, 2, 3. I got hearts beating in the wind. Yeah.
I really cannot name another band that has more versatility. And a lot of it is driven by Elton's songs. His albums are a lot like Beatles records. When you would buy a Beatles record, you never knew what was coming next. You'd put on the, you know, side one, a new album that you'd never heard before, and it's like, whoa, where'd that come from? That's totally different than the next thing and the thing before. Elton's records were a lot that way too. He was so all over the place. He had so much versatility in his songwriting, his playing ability, his vocal style. So the band responded to that. And I really have never heard a band that can play something like that. So funky and just in the pocket. And when I talk about the band, I'm talking about Elton as well. I'm not just talking about Dee and Nigel and Davey. I'm talking about the four of them as a band. The pocket is so deep, I could get lost in it. And then they, once again, they turn around and play the most beautiful, subtle, gorgeous, ethereal ballad. There's nobody else that was covering this kind of range with this kind of skill and this kind of authority. That's the thing about these performances. There's so much authority in them and so much confidence. Jumping ahead, this is 1974. This is from a live album that Elton released, and it's called Here and There. And the incredible thing to me about this album is that I never see it recognized on lists of great albums. And in fact, when this album was released, it was criticized a lot by music critics, being the brilliant people that they are, thinking that it was just kind of a throwaway thing. This album is not a throwaway. It captures the Elton John band. By this time, they've added Davey to the band and Ray Cooper on percussion. Certainly one of the finest, if not the finest, rock percussionists in music. And this is them. They're playing in London. It's still Dee and Nigel on drums. And Davey was added to the band in 1972 for the album Honky Chateau. So the band had toured for that album. They had toured to promote the next album, which was Don't Shoot Me, I'm Only the Piano Player. They had also toured to promote Goodbye Yellow Brick Road. This is right on the verge of the tour when they were going to promote the Caribou album. This is Honky Cat from London in 1974.
Fishing in a stream, looking for an answer, trying to find a sign. Till I saw your city lights, honey, I was blind. They said, get back, a honky cat.
Oh, listen to that groove. Davey is not actually playing guitar in this. He's playing mandolin. Just check out his playing and what he adds to this track. And also notice how Ray Cooper, is the tambourine, is kind of giving this song a really super solid rhythm feel to it. But just check out the drums and the bass. Listen to Dee Murray's bass.
And all the folks back home said I was a fool. They said, I said, get back, honky cat. Oh, you better get back to the woods. Well, I quit those days now. My bad neck weighs on. Oh, 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 the change is gonna do me good. All right, honky, let's see it now.
This is Davey on mandolin. Incredible. My goodness. As you're listening to these tracks, anytime you listen to Elton John's records, live, studio, whatever, when you listen to Dee Murray, especially live, every measure of the song. You never know what's going to happen. He never plays the same thing twice. Every corner of the song is like a new adventure in what he's going to do. And Gus Dudgeon, the producer that produced all those legendary 70s albums, is quoted in a video, the making of the Goodbye Yellow Brick Road documentary.
This is the Ballad of Danny Bailey, and it really shows off Dee Murray's bass playing, which I think is superb. He's an underrated and superb musician. His sense of melody and his sense of understanding the lyric and the way that the whole thing has to feel was, as far as I'm concerned, faultless. I've never really come across a bass player quite as good as him. So I'm going to leave him in so you can hear a bit of what he's doing on the front, because it's very unusual what he does. So here we go, Danny Bailey.
Some punk with a shotgun killed young Danny Bailey in cold blood in the lobby of a downtown motel.
Now here comes Dee now, listen.
Killed him in anger, a force he couldn't handle. Help pull the trigger that cut short his life. And there's not many knew him the way that we did. Sure enough, he was a wild one, but then on those tongue kids,
And here's the rhythm section.
Danny Bailey, we're gonna have to break up our stills. So mark his grave well, 'cause Kentucky loved him. Born and raised a proper, I guess life just bugged him. And he found faith in danger, a lifestyle he lived by.
Absolutely agree with that, and I have felt that way for decades. And I actually worked with Dee. He sat right next to me, and I watched him play on my music. I've never seen anyone with the breadth of skill, versatility, the natural musicality, the intuition about what to play, the groove. Many of Elton John's greatest tracks, if you listen to them, Dee's bass part set the whole tone and feel of the song. Philadelphia Freedom being a great example of that. This is Philadelphia Freedom. It's just bass, drums, and Elton's vocal. His bass is just freaky.
I used to be a Rolling Stone, you know. If the cause was right,
yeah,
I'd leave to find an answer on the road. I used to be a heart beating for someone, but the times have changed.
A The less
I say, the more my work gets done. Cause I live and breathe this Philadelphia freedom. From the day that I was born, I waved the flag. Philadelphia freedom took me knee high to a man. Yeah. Give me a piece of mind my daddy never had. Oh, Philadelphia freedom,
yeah,
shine on me. I love you, shine a light through the eyes of the one left behind. Shine the light, shine the light, won't you shine the light. Philadelphia freedom, I love you. Yes, I do.
D, he is the one that creates the whole groove of that song. Nigel is literally doing nothing but hitting his hi-hat and a tom hit. Elton is playing this kind of sparse electric piano in it. Awesome guitars and beautiful string arrangement. But anyway, you get my point. The other side of the Here and There album is a performance in November of 1974 in Madison Square Garden, New York City. This is an incredibly legendary show because this is the night that John Lennon came on stage and joined them. By the way, the version of Here and There that I'm playing is not the 90s reissue when they expanded it and Gus Dudgeon remixed the entire show, which was awesome. I was so excited about that. But when I listened to the original release of Here and There, which was just a single album, five cuts from one show, five cuts from the other show, I preferred those mixes to the remixes that were done in the 90s. The original 70s mix sounds to me more like the band really sounded. The 90s version has a lot of modern reverbs on it. Gus remixed it and he tended to bury Davey's guitar a lot. This 70s version is just the guitar is right out there. The drums sound like they're just dry and right in your face, and you can really hear Dee's bass, and Elton's piano sounds beautiful, very analog recording. You can really see why he chose these particular tracks for that original album release, because these performances are just stunning. And I'm going to play Funeral for a Friend. This is them opening the show in New York, actually on Thanksgiving Day of 1974. He's at the peak. There's no one bigger in the world than Elton John at this point. And any musician will tell you that there's no greater place to play than Madison Square Garden. So I just want to set the stage as you listen to these tracks recorded that night. You're hearing this band at the absolute pinnacle of their popularity, of their skill. Also consider the fact that they know John Lennon is going to be coming out on stage with them. They've been hanging with John Lennon, rehearsing with him, hanging out with him before this show. That in itself must have put these musicians in such a excited state of mind. So when you listen to these tracks from the Here and There album, think about that. It really adds a special sort of intensity to this, to listening to these. At least it does for me. But just imagine being in the audience with the rumors that had been floating around that John might be showing up for this show. Guitar. Nigel riding that sizzle cymbal. and Elton's piano is so sublime. The girl screams out, "Elton!" When Gus Dudgeon remixed this for the 90s release, you can't hear that girl screaming anymore. Listen to that guitar. You know, the synthesizer parts were missing. It does not matter. This is just so rocking. Audience totally freaking out. Check out Dee's bass through this entire performance. Love that bass, the space that he leaves right there. These guys are on fire.
Somehow I love not being
Okay, so, you know, Elton is just, you can just hear that these guys are absolutely on top of the world, so in their zone. And his piano playing is just out of this world. Okay, now check out this part. Ray Cooper. Doing that tambourine. Ray Cooper and Nigel hitting that kick drum. Elton singing the high part with the guitar. These guys are just exploding. Once again, listen to Dee's bass, man. And then Nigel sings above Elton. Awesome. Check out this outro. Listen to that bass. Man, I've listened to this recording hundreds of times, and it still just sends me flying. It's so incredibly awesome. They are just so smoking hot, man. What an incredible song to open a concert with. Funeral for a Friend, Love Lies Bleeding. Obviously, Goodbye Yellow Brick Road is Elton just creating such original music and so cinematic and exciting and powerful, and Bernie's writing these incredibly cinematic lyrics, and everything about what was happening for Elton, his band, Gus Dudgeon being the perfect producer that understood the talents of all of those four guys and knew exactly how to, you know, to guide them, to edit where needed, but ultimately to empower them to express all of their gifts and their talents, which are vast.
He'll get up early or whatever, and he has words. If Bernie's not here, he'll have lyrics. And he'll sit down at the piano and sort of play about, and within half an hour, he's written a song, you know. There's never a note written down. He keeps it in his head.
When we did Tonky Chateau, Bernie was here writing the lyrics, bringing them downstairs. Elton was sitting at the piano writing them. And then half an hour later, we'd sit down and learn them, the band, you know. And that's the way it goes.
Literally just, as quickly as that?
Oh, yeah. It's amazing. It was just like a factory. The lyrics were coming down. Elton was sitting down and writing the song. And we'd be sitting having breakfast, and we'd just join in. And within about an hour and a half, we've got the basis of the song.
And at that stage, you're busking it.
Oh, sure, yeah, we just learn the song.
To say to somebody, I know somebody who writes great songs and he can write 10 in half an hour, you'd think, come on, you know, they can't be that great. But he does that.
She packed my bags last night to fly. Soon at 9 a.m. And I'm gonna be high as a kite by then. I miss the earth so much. I miss my wife.
That bass right there.
It's lonely out of space. On such a timeless flight.
Tambourine comes in. John, once he started playing these songs in the 80s, the tempos were really fast.
Gonna be a long, long time. It's gonna be a long.
When Elton and the band were playing in these days, they could play the most intense rock song, but when they played these ballads like Daniel and Rocket Man and Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me, you hear the beauty of particularly Nigel, the way that he would lay back on the beat so far. And if you really pay attention to the ballads, that's one of the trademarks of Nigel Olsson's drumming. It almost gives these songs this ethereal, languid feeling because there's nothing about them that is urgent. It's like they're just, it's like you're just floating on a pillow of magic, a magical music pillow. But really pay attention to how Elton in his piano playing and Dee bass playing, Nigel on drums, they're in this deep pocket that's so relaxed, and it makes these songs so beautiful.
I think it's gonna be a long, long time. Touchdown brings me round again to find. Not the man that can climb, I know. No. I'm a rocket man. Rocket man, burning out as soon as I'm here alone.
Bass right there.
It's gonna be a long time. touchdown, brings me right again to find.
I love this.
I'm not the man you think I am at home.
Elton at the top of his vocal beat.
Rocket man burning out his fuse up him alone. I think it's gonna be a long, long time.
So sublime.
I think it's gonna be a long, long time.
Wow, that bass right there. I really encourage you, if you're an Elton John fan, go back and listen to these live recordings. They are truly a band at their pinnacle, their peak. Okay, this is a song from Elton's first album, and by this time, Nigel and Dee and Elton had played this song so many times together. So when you're hearing it now in 1974, they've played this for a long time and they have this so locked in. I love what Elton did to the beginning of this, the way he intros this song and Davey comes in with his heroic electric guitar leads.
And I'm here in your prison.
Man.
Like a coin in your mint. I am tempted. And I'm smitten with hot treason.
Jeez.
Well, I know you ain't old, and I'm told, and I'm told, he's a virgin.
I'd love to sit here and play these entire tracks and freak out. I wish you were all here with me and we could geek out together, but I want to cover some other stuff. Interplay between Nigel and Ray Cooper, and man, Ray Cooper is such a brilliant percussionist, playing such tasty, impeccably cool parts in these arrangements. This is Burn Down the Mission that is on the 90s version of Here and There. This is them playing in London. Just gonna play a little bit of it, this middle section. It's our only chance, oh. What a killer drum. Okay, this is from the 90s mix of the New York show. Just going to play a little bit of Daniel. Pay attention to how much Dee Murray's bass playing really sets the whole feel of this song.
Daniel is traveling tonight on a plane. I can see the red tail light.
Love this drum fill. That's something that Nigel never does anymore, are those cool little fills.
Oh, it looks like Daniel. Must be the clouds in my eyes. Says Spain is pretty, though I've never been. Daniel says it's the best place.
Besides that little drum fill that he does in the middle of the verse there, the only other drummer I know that does would play these cool little tasty fills in rather odd places in the middle of a song was Ringo. Ringo used to do that kind of stuff all the time. Nigel also does that kind of stuff, and you should look for that. You know, most drummers will play a drum fill that leads into the beginning of a verse or at the end of a verse into a chorus, whatever. Nigel used to throw in these really cool, tasty little fills in odd little spots in the song. Such an incredibly tasty, one-of-a-kind drummer. There's nobody that sounded like Nigel. I'm assuming most of you that are watching this have heard the very famous part of this New York concert when John Lennon comes on stage. They open up with Whatever Gets You Through the Night, which was John's current number one hit single, I believe. Then they do Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, which was, of course, John's song that Elton had re-recorded in a beautiful, impeccable cover version of that. Then they end with I Saw Her Standing There. And you can hear all of this on the 90s reissue of Here and There. Almost the entire show is on that collection. This was such a historic night in rock music and really the pinnacle moment for Elton and his band. I don't think it ever got any more exciting or more special than this night. John Lennon comes on. There's this incredible reaction to John Lennon. By all accounts, it felt like the whole place was going to fall apart because the reaction to seeing John on stage was so intense. All of the band members have been interviewed about this. Elton's been interviewed about it countless times. It was so emotional for them and the audience. It was just this incredibly intense moment in time, as you can imagine. So this is after John has finished. He's left the stage. And then the band goes into this.
3, 4.
I can't lie, no more of your darkness. All my pictures seem to fade to black and white. I'm growing tired. Time stands still before me. Frozen here on the ladder of my life. Too late to save myself from falling. Took a chance and changed your way of life.
Absolutely sublime.
But you misread about me and when I met you. Close the door.
So lovely.
I can't find all the right romantic line.
I'll talk about this later when I play the studio version, but Davey is playing his guitar through a Leslie speaker, which is not a guitar amplifier. It's actually an organ amplifier. If you're interested in how he gets that creamy, interesting sound, just Google Leslie speaker and you'll learn. It's a really interesting and unique sound.
But these cuts I have, baby, love.
say something about this drum fill that's coming up that Nigel does. It's one of the greatest drum fills ever recorded.
Everything is like the sun goes down on me.
When Elton finishes the song, he says, "Incredible, thank you." In the thousands of performances I've listened to him, he has never, ever said anything like that. He is so in such a special moment here.
Incredible, thank you.
This is a really, really special night for him and that band and the people of New York City. I highly recommend that you get the 90s reissue of Here and There and listen to that concert. It is truly stellar. And also buy the original 70s issue. If you're a real fanatic, a real freak like I am, buy it just for the cool original mixes. I mentioned a little bit earlier in Don't Let the Sun Go Down on Me how there is this amazing drum fill. I want to just talk a little bit about this drum fill. I'm going to play the studio version. Nigel does something that I've rarely heard anyone do before, a drummer or even a band. At the beginning of the fill, Nigel pulls the tempo back. He deliberately starts the beginning of the fill slower than the tempo that the band was already traveling at. And the whole band follows him. It's like they get sucked into this vacuum where he starts this fill and it's so dramatic and it's completely for dramatic purposes and emphasis. If you notice at the very beginning of this roll, he's kind of like dun 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 dun. It's like he picks up speed, and it's a totally deliberate thing. It takes such skill and such musicality to do something like this. Right here. I love that little da-da-da-da, that little piano part right there. I'm really geeking out, you guys. I'm sorry, I can't help it. It's not what you think. There's a prime example of those kind of drum fills I'm talking about, where Nigel would just throw them into the middle of some place where they didn't necessarily, it wouldn't be the predictable place to play a fill. So awesome, so perfect. He goes to the ride right there. So cool. I have a good friend, Juan Van Dunk. Juan and I first met and started playing music together. He was playing bass in my band. One of our touchstones as friends was we talked about when we were kids, and we used to hear Benny and the Jets on the radio. And he said that he was so mesmerized by that track. And I said I was too. It was like it was transporting me into this totally different place with the audience sounds, and just the vibe of the track is so interesting and so unique. Try and name another track that sounds like Benny and the Jets. You won't find one. It's so Elton. It's so uniquely Elton, his artistry and his creativity and the bands. But one of the things that Juan said to me was, as a little kid, he'd hear this song and it would make him cry. And I don't know if you musicians out there, you might relate to this. That's what music used to do to me when I was a kid too. There were the certain music was just so beautiful but magical, and when Juan said that to me, it just, I can't even explain to you what that meant to me. It was kind of our moment that we really bonded. It's like, yeah, we understand. For musicians and artists, music is different. Not to say that non-musicians cannot enjoy it in the same way, but there's just something, I think there's something about music and the way it impacts musicians that basically forces them to become musicians. It's like they can't help it. They're so just compelled to do it and drawn to it. And anyway, I wanted to share that little moment about Benny and the Jets. This is Sweet Painted Lady. Once again, this is just drums, bass, piano. This music, Elton, the songs he was composing, the chord changes, and the way that these guys rose to the occasion. Whew, amazing. This is a mix that many of you have probably heard, but I really need to just play this because it singles out these incredible background vocals. Dee, Nigel, and Davey were the ones that arranged and created all of these incredibly beautiful background vocal arrangements. And Nigel and Dee and Elton and Davey would basically cut the basic tracks in the studio. Elton would just, once they got the basic track down, he'd take off and then he would leave them to do these beautiful, incredible, inventive, and highly original background vocal parts. And then Davey would do these amazing overdubs, and I'm going to do separate videos about kind of looking at Davey's artistry and Nigel's artistry and Dee's artistry, but right now I'm just kind of taking a look at the group of them. But check out these vocals.
Goodbye, Norma Jean. Though I never knew you at all, you had the grace to hold yourself while those around you crawled. goodbye, Norma Jean. From a young man in the 22nd row who sees you as something more than sexual, more than just our Marilyn Monroe. And it seems to me you lived your life like a candle in the wind.
Cool.
Never knowing who to cling to when the rain set in. And I would have liked to know you, but I was just a kid. Your candle burned out long before your legend ever did.
She.
Your candle burned out long before your legend ever did.
Guys, I'm going to have a stroke from joy. Incredible. Okay, I want to talk a little bit about the Captain Fantastic album. You know, most people regard Goodbye Yellow Brick Road as their peak achievement, and it is obviously just an amazing album. It's sort of like the Elton John Band, Sgt. Pepper, but just like the Beatles had a white album, Elton John and his band had a white album, and I would say that it was Captain Fantastic and the Brown Dirt Cowboy. From what Dee told me, they spent more time in the studio recording this album than any of the other albums. Caribou Ranch in Colorado was the place where Chicago made their best sounding records. A lot of bands made their best sounding records at Caribou Ranch. So Elton and his band had this chunk of time that they could really invest into this album. Elton had written this amazing autobiographical collection of songs. Bernie's lyrics are brilliant. So this album, to me, is not only artistically and creatively probably their finest moment, but it's also one of the finest sounding records ever recorded, in my opinion. If you ever want to demonstrate what analog recording sounds like to someone, this is a great go-to album. This album is truly, it's just a masterpiece of sonic quality, audio engineering, playing, songs, lyrics, not to mention impeccable cover design and artwork and booklets and stuff that comes in the record. It's an amazing package and an amazing album. But I want you to listen to this. This is the title track, Captain Fantastic. This is after Elton has introed the song. This is where the band comes in.
Brown Dirt Cowboy, still green and growing, city's the captain. Fantastic the feedback, the honey the hive could be holding.
Beautiful percussion by Ray Cooper.
Winging young sparrows, starving the winter, broken young children on wheels out the winners, and the 68 summer festival wore flowers a thin air. The chief is a meal, a hardly a home on the range. Too hot for the band, with a desperate desire for change. We've thrown in the towel too many times, out for the count and when we're down. Captain Fantastic Band, Brown Dirt Cowboy from there, and all the world to your town.
The playing and everything about this album is incredible, but this song is so unique and such an original track, not only for them, but for any bands of the 1970s. This is a masterpiece of arrangement, songwriting, vocal arrangements. The recording is incredible. The treatment on Nigel's drum is so cool. Just check this out.
Someone had drawn on.
enough time for the night to pass by without warning. Away in the distance, there's a blue flashing light. Someone's in trouble, somewhere tonight, as the flickering neon stands ready to fuse. The wind blows away all of yesterday's news.
Cool guitar.
Well, they've locked up their daughters and they've battened the hatches. They always could find us, but they never could catch us. Through the grease-streaked window of an all-night cafe, we watched the arrested get taken away, and that cigarette haze is ecology beam as the horns and the drums filed in from the street.
Check this out.
Cause the steam's in the boilers, the coals in the fire. If you ask how I am, then I just say I'm fire. If the thought of a rose is the thought in your side, then you're better off dead if you haven't yet died.
Vocals. Okay, this Captain Fantastic album is amazing. There was no singles on it, except for Someone Saved My Life Tonight, which wasn't one of Elton's great big hit singles. Just like the White Album didn't have any singles on it, but man, what an album. Gonna play a couple more tracks. This is the remake that Elton and band did of Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. Listen to that drum sound. Cool guitar. I'm going to move a little bit further ahead to the middle section of this song. Just musically, it really takes off. Bass. So cool. What an amazing amazing recording and achievement this is. One of the greatest cover versions of a song I've ever heard in my life. Dee told me when I was talking to him about this track, he told me that it was Lennon that introduced that reggae, that weird part in the middle. John was there at the session, played guitar on this track, and that John was the one that started doing the little reggae lick, and it's so cool. And all the little intricate and textured sounds that are a part of that recording. I hope you guys are listening to this on headphones, because, man, Elton John's albums, his music is so awesome on headphones. So many cool stereo things that Davey Johnstone used to do with his guitars, double-tracking his guitars and splitting them left and right, and just magical. If you, when I say headphones, I mean, you know, earbuds or headphones or whatever. I want to play a really cool track I have of the vocal, so you can really hear John Lennon sing in the chorus.
Lucy in the sky with diamonds. Lucy in the sky with diamonds. Lucy in the sky with diamonds.
Oh! It's a tape recorder. It basically boils down to that. Each key represents a tape recorder. But instead of it having two reels and it just goes to the end and it stops, it's actually looped. So as I press the note, the string play, the tape plays and goes into the bin.
I hope you've enjoyed this. I'm going to do one more track. I'm going to show you that nobody could play rock music like Elton and the Elton John Band. Elton's version of Pinball Wizard is also amazing. It's because he was such a fan of these guys. Careful attention to all the incredible stuff Davey Johnstone is doing on this track.
He plays by intuition, that digit can't us fall, that deaf, dumb, and blind kid. John plays mean pinball. He's a pinball wizard, there has to be a twist. A pinball wizard got such a
man. Johnstone's guitar tones on this and Captain Fantastic are so killer, the whole album. This is the last thing they recorded together, by the way.
I thought I was the battle table king, but I got a hand in my pinball ground to hell. To hell. To hell.
Bass. Killer. Those guys, just amazing. For now, I've got to stop geeking out because I think I'm going to have a stroke. Anyway, thank you for watching. I hope you guys have enjoyed it. I love Elton's music so much, and I have so much respect and admiration for the musicians that played on these records, and Gus Dudgeon as a producer, Bernie Taupin as a lyricist. Just like the Beatles were this amalgamation that created something so magical, that's what was happening with those guys at that moment, and I don't think enough people understand that. The Elton John Band should be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. So should Gus Dudgeon, as far as I'm concerned. But they're not. There's no excuse. The music's there, and people should listen to it. It's just truly amazing music and a treasure trove of impeccable work. I've really been on this Elton John kick lately, and so I appreciate you letting me indulge myself. I hope you'll subscribe. It would really help me out. I hope you'll hit the thumbs up, and I would really appreciate it if you would share my video channel with anyone that you think might like it. And there's so much stuff on YouTube, it's really hard to break through and gain an audience. There's so many things I'd like to do. So anyway, thank you for watching. Have a great day, morning, evening, or whatever. But whatever you do, listen to some Elton John. Okay? Cool. See ya. Ooh!